When you hear a show tune from the Great White Way, does a shiver run through ya? Well, we're giving them to ya. Sing hallelujah and shout hooray. Come on along and listen to Broadway to Main Street, USA.
Bed, bed, I couldn't go to bed. My head's too light to try to set it down. Sleep, sleep, I couldn't sleep tonight. Not for all the jewels in the crown. I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night. And still have begged for more. I could have spread my wings and done a thousand things.
And dear listeners, you will be dancing all night and singing all night and celebrating in the street all night on Sunday, July 17th at the West Hampton Performing Arts Center, because you will get the chance to see Kelli O'Hara live and in person doing what she does best, which is sing the great classics of the American musical theater. This is Larry Maslon, your host for Broadway to Main Street here on 88.3 FM. WLIW, Long Island's only signature, one-of-a-kind, individual NPR station. And I'm thrilled to be joined by Kelli O'Hara herself. Welcome, Kelli.
Thank you, Larry. It's nice to be here.
Well, you have conquered just about everything there is to conquer: the stage, the concert hall, the opera hall, and HBO television's The Gilded Age, which, you know, is just going into its second season and has this huge fan base. You are referred to as the most accomplished musical theater performer of your generation. I think it's time to take "of her generation" out and just put you in there with some of the greats of all time. I'm so impressed by how many great scores you've not only performed and recorded in, but what dignity and grace you've lent to them. So we're going to hear a few of those today. And prep audiences for this concert at West Hampton Beach Performing Arts Center. You're from Oklahoma, a part of Oklahoma, I gather, where they breed musical comedy stars.
Well, some people say what's in the water down there, yes.
So you and Kristen Chenoweth came from roughly the same neck of the... You had the same teacher, correct?
That's correct. We went to Oklahoma City University at different times, but we did share the wonderful mentor, Florence Birdwell. And she sent a lot of people up to New York. And there are many, many other people that have gone to New York to do musicals and theater and the arts in general. I think Oklahoma breeds a sort of person who... Since it isn't, there's a lot of art in Oklahoma. I shouldn't say that, but because it's not near New York, you end up sort of dreaming and making your own idea about it all. And I think that leads you to theater, to be in the creative, imaginative arts. It certainly did me. I just dreamed of it and dreamed of it. And then one day found myself there finally.
Well, I first remember you as a lass in New Amsterdam in Knickerbocker Holiday. And let's hear you render a beautiful Kurt Weill song.
I think I'd forgive you anything except not wanting me. But you've been away for weeks and no word from you.
I was trying to make myself stay away so my curse wouldn't light on you too. But it was no use. Wherever I went, I kept looking for you. I've been hunting through woods. I've been fishing over water for one certain girl who's a certain father's daughter. I've been following trails. I've been staring after ships for a certain pair of eyes and a certain pair of lips. Yes, I looked everywhere. You can look without wings. And I found a great variety of interesting things. But it never was you. It never was anywhere you. An occasional sunset reminded me of a flower growing high on a tulip tree, or one red star hung low in the west, or a heartbreak call from the meadowlark's nest made me think for a moment, maybe it's true. Your father's house and marry me?
My father has arranged for me to marry someone else, but let's just hope that something will happen. And next time, don't stay away so long, because I've been running through rains and the winds that follow after for one certain face and an unforgotten laughter. I've been searching through the lands for a certain pair of arms and a certain pair of hands. Oh, I tried a kiss here and I tried a kiss there. For when you're out in sunset reminded me of a flower growing high on a tulip tree, or one red star hung low in the west, or a heartbreak call from the meadowlark's nest made me think for a moment, maybe it's true. Yeah.
I ended up getting my degree in opera rather than musical theater, just because I had a more classical sensibility. I tried, believe me, I tried to sing the pop things and the current things, but my voice just it just found itself that way. And so I sang a lot of Kurt Weill in college and an art song. And so when Ted Sperling and the Master Voices asked me to do Knickerbocker Holiday, it just felt very natural. And I find occasion to sing that way, whether it be in opera. But my great love is the Great American Songbook, for sure.
Well, I gather, I don't know if this is, you can confirm this or not, that when you arrived in New York, I guess a little bit like the actress in, what is it, Act One of Annie, you saw Marin Mazzie in Ragtime 8 times.
That's correct. Good research.
Tell me why that was so inspirational to you.
Well, I should preface by saying that, you know, I didn't visit New York until I was 21 at all. And the first musical I ever saw on Broadway was Masterclass, starring Audra McDonald. And that voice and seeing, you know, people sing arias on a Broadway stage, for me, sort of tricked me into believing that I could move to Broadway and make it, you know. And it was a good trick because I ended up coming. But then when I first moved here, which was that fall of 98, Audra and Marin Mazzie were starring in Ragtime. And to go 8 times, I guess, to go 8 times and see these incredible actresses, but singing round classically, in a classical way, just inspired me that I could make a place here, you know, because at that time, Rent and, you know, Scarlet Pimpernel and different pop musicals were happening. And I felt, I really feared that I wouldn't find my way. And that show and those particular women, and then of course, Marin was such a sort of a template, you know, I admired her so much in every way and thought, oh, well, I can be like her. You know, if I really work hard, I could try. And now I know it's pieces of her that I wanted to take with me, but that finding my own individual thing was the way to go.
Well, what a beautiful tribute to such a beautiful artist.
I am not letting you go, Susan.
You say these words, you make it sound so clear. And then there comes another wave of fear. My brother's voice is ringing in my ear.
I offer you. I offer you me.
Leave the madness, have your future, make your music, let it play. Take your freedom, hold the memory, say goodbye, and walk away.
I know you had a particular vibe working with Marvin Hamlisch on Sweet Smell of Success. I think he's not appreciated quite enough as a musical theater composer. Tell us a little bit about that experience. And I know you've gone on to record other of his works and just what your feelings are about him.
Oh, Marvin was such a special person in my life. I mean, he and that team gave me my first big Broadway role in Sweet Smell of Success. Now, the show wasn't a huge success, obviously, but what it taught me was this, you know, this ambition and this love of becoming more of a leading lady as opposed to, you know, doing the chorus. And I loved that. But to have that first shot and with someone like Marvin, you know, to give you a little insight into him, years after I did Sweet Smell of Success, my parents called in Oklahoma and said, you know, you'll never believe this. There had been a tornado and out of nowhere, and nor do I know how he got my phone, their phone number. She said, Marvin Hamlisch just called us to make sure we were okay.
Wow.
And so he was the kind of person who just, he was not only an artist and a professional, you know, master, but he was a personal love. You know, he was just the kind of person who took on things deeply and took on people deeply. And he was so incredibly encouraging to me. And I miss him. I miss him all the time. He was taken way too soon.
Yeah, he seemed like such a mensch, you know.
Absolutely.
You've played almost every major part in the American musical, but this, sometimes you get to play characters like Nellie Forbush. I mean, Arkansas is right nearby, and a little bit of, I thought, Babe in Pajama Game, and I guess Clara in some way in Light in the Piazza had some of that Southern background. Is that something you enjoy bringing to your roles, or is that just a coincidence?
Well, no, I enjoy it. I certainly do. I mean, especially in the case of Nellie Forbush, my mother's whole family is from Arkansas, and there was a lot that I knew about that particular character, good and bad. And I definitely wanted to get inside that and give her some humanity and also, you know, let her grow within the show, which is on the page. But I also wanted to bring that familiarity to it. But as actors, I think that we better be careful not to just play ourselves. The point of being an actor is to really step outside and put yourselves in the shoes of others and learn sympathies and educate yourself on others' experiences. And so as much as I enjoy playing Nellie, I enjoy the other things that are unlike myself even more.
I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way. Get the picture? I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms and send him on his way. Don't try to patch it up.
Tear it up, tear it up.
Wash him out, dry him out.
Push him out, fly him out.
Cancel him and let him go.
Yay, sister! I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way.
If the man don't understand you, if you fly on separate beams, waste no time, make a change. Ride that man right off your range. Rub him out of the roll call and drum him out of your dreams.
Oh-ho!
If you laugh at different comics, if you root for different teams,
waste no time, weep no more. Show him what the door is for. Rub him out of the roll call.
All wet.
No.
You can't make a butterfly strong.
Uh-uh.
You can't fix an egg when it ain't quite good.
And you can't fix a man when he's wrong.
You can't put back a petal when it falls from a flower, or sweeten up a feller when he starts turning sour.
Oh no! Oh no!
We'll be right back.
washed that man right out of my hair. I went and washed that man right out of my hair. I went and washed that man right out of my hair and sent him on his way.
She went and washed that man right out of her hair. She went and washed that man right out of her hair. She went and washed that man right out of her hair and sent him on his way.
Tell me.
I love you more than all the heroes in all the history books.
Tell me.
Oh, what a woman. I'll tell ya. There once was a man who loved a woman. She was the one he slew the dragon for. They say that nobody ever loved as much as he. But me, I love you more.
Tell me.
And there once was a man who loved a woman. She was the one he gave his kingdom for. They say that nobody ever loved as much as he. But me, I love you more. My love is a giant, fierce and defiant. But how can I prove it to you? Ain't got no kingdom, no dragon to back up my bragging. How can I show what I would do? I only know there once was a man who loved a woman. She was the one he ate the apple for. They say that nobody ever loved as much as he. But me, I love you more.
She took poison for. They say that nobody ever loved as much as she. But me, I love you more.
Tell me.
And there was a woman who loved a man. He was the one she swam the channel for. They say that nobody ever loved as much as she. Solar plexus, it's bigger than Texas. I just can't tell you how it feels. I only know there once was a woman who loved a man. Loved him enough to cause the Trojan War. They say that nobody ever loved as much as she. But me, I love you more, 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 more.
More than a hangman loves his rope.
More than a dope fiend loves his dope.
More than an engine loves his scalp.
More than a yodeler loves his house.
More,
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 more. Once was a man,
once was a woman,
who loved a woman.
Loved a man.
She was the one he slew
the
dragon
for.
They say that nobody ever loved as much as he. But me,
I love you more.
Now, when it comes to Rodgers and Hammerstein, you are the definitive portrayer of their works. And you've done so much of their stuff. Obviously, South Pacific, which you were such a knockout in, Carousel, which has been recorded for television, King and I, for which you won your Tony. I guess you've done, did you ever do Laurie in Oklahoma, of all things?
You know, it's funny. I finally did. I always wanted to do Laurie. Laurie was the first musical I ever saw when I was four.
Oh, wow.
But I didn't get a chance to play her ever until they did a centennial birthday production in 2007 in Oklahoma to celebrate the birthday. And I finally played Laurie at an age much too old to play her. But I enjoyed it so much. And I mean, I knew the songs like the back of my hand.
Sure.
And But I did. I grew up on all of that for obvious reasons. And I've so loved the fact that I've gotten to play, you know, I've never done The Sound of Music, which is odd. But other than that, I think I've really, that canon, I've sort of worked my way through.
Wow. Well, you can probably skip me and Juliet, I think. But what is it? I like that score. What is it about them? I mean, obviously, it's not just Rodgers and Hammerstein. It seems to me they are larger than the sum of their parts, right? Mm. The way they, the way Rodgers understands character musically, and the way Hammerstein knows how to develop a character through this particular idiom. What is it about them that has allowed you to do such tremendous performances of their work? What's the connection there for you?
That's an, you know, I think I'm such a lyric driven person. I always have been, because that's what Florence Birdwell, my teacher, really taught. Her technique was called speaking on pitch, she would say. But when I think about the kind of voice that I really believe I was born with, because, you know, you can study and you can train, but you open your mouth to sing and there's a certain timbre, there's a certain, you know, a range. I have to give Rodgers so much of that credit, because the roundness and the range of those characters that I played musically is what made me feel was most fitting. I don't think it's because I was singing that as a young age. I think when I open my mouth to sing it at any time, it's just, it fits me and I can't really explain it. And to then, and maybe you're going to get to this, but then to sort of graduate to Richard Rodgers' grandson, who writes right. incredibly different, Adam Gettle, to sing his music almost like it's falling out of my throat in a way that, you know, there's a lot of music I sing, but I have to work hard to make it happen. But these two, not so. It just feels like I was born to do it, and I don't know why. I can't explain it.
Who can explain it? Who can tell you why?
Yeah, I can't, who can explain it? Who can tell you why? I do also, though, the combination for me of the lyric and the melodies must have been the major thing that struck me, because I always feel like that combination of the two of them just really spoke to me, and it speaks to me all the time.
Whenever I feel afraid, I hold my head erect and whistle a happy tune so no one will suspect I'm afraid. While shivering in my shoes, I strike a careless pose and whistle a happy tune, and no one ever knows I'm afraid. The result of this deception is very strange to tell, for when I fool the people I fear, I fool myself as well. I whistle a happy tune, and every single time the happiness in the tune convinces me that I'm not afraid. Make believe you're brave, and the trick will take you far. You may be as brave as you make believe you are. This deception is very strange to tell, for when I fool the people I fear, I fool myself as well. I whistle a happy tune, and every single time the happiness in the tune convinces me that I'm not afraid. Make believe you're brave, and the trick will take you far. You may be as brave as you make believe you are. You may be as brave as you make believe you are.
And now to pay tribute to Carousel on its 75th anniversary, here is Tony Award winner Kelli O'Hara.
I've often felt that if you came from Mars and you saw the duet, If I Loved You from Carousel, you would understand everything because his emotional language through music is just so true and so empathic for listeners.
Yeah, that particular piece, I'm glad you brought that up because I actually, Carousel, the waltz, the overture is my favorite piece of music in the world.
How wonderful.
And I know that the show itself has been deemed more difficult these days, and I think it is. But I also stand by the fact that there are subject matters that just because we don't want to talk about them don't mean they don't happen, you know. So it's like we need to tell stories, but we can find new ways to tell them. But that particular number, especially when I did it with the New York Philharmonic and Nathan Gunn, and the way it was lit and the way the room felt and the cherry blossoms falling down from the top of... Musically, I feel there was some sort of liftoff that happened in my body, and I feel like I'll never have that quite that same experience again in my life. And nobody knew this, but I was 3 months pregnant.
Wow!
When I played Julie, and that's just an experience that you look back on and you say, "I wish I could have it again," but boy, thank God I had it at least once.
Sure, how wonderful! I'm talking here with Kelli O'Hara, who is going to be appearing in our neck of the woods at the West Hampton Beach Performing Arts Center on Sunday, July 17th at 8 p.m. You will not want to miss this. It will make your summer. It will make your July 4th and your Bastille Day all come together. And you can call 631-288-1500 or go to whbpac.org. This is going to be definitely a highlight of the summer for all of us out here on the East End. We're talking about R&H, and I think of someone like Mary Martin, who got to work with them twice, writing new musicals, writing them for her, on her. But you've had a tremendous opportunity to work on new musicals with some of our finest new voices, Jason Robert Brown and Adam Gettle. in, you know, career shattering performances in Light in the Piazza. And then, of course, in Bridges of Madison County. What's that like? I mean, what do you bring from your classical training to these newer writers who are expanding the form in very different and challenging ways?
Well, you know, that's been one of my favorite parts of my career. You know, I always look at roles equally the same, which is I look at the source material and try to find out why it speaks to me. You know, I sort of metabolize it and go forward, as opposed to looking at other performances or, you know, visiting Mary Martin's performances. I love them, but I don't want to do that because then it would just be doing the same thing. But when I get a chance to be in the room with a writer and create something from the start, there's this great joy in not only taking the material and seeing how it affects me, but also speaking up for the material, speaking up for myself, saying it would be great if she could feel this way, or she could, you know, she could vocalize it this way. And when I mentioned before, I was trying to find my spot in musical theater, being from the classical world. I had these writers who listened to that question and said, well, as a composer, what can I do to put it more in Kelly's wheelhouse, you know, as opposed to just writing what I would normally write. So that's a big challenge for them as well. And both of them in very different ways did that for me. You know, they didn't write what would be the normal sort of belt musical theater sound. Mm-hmm. They put things in a more, especially with Francesca from the Bridges of Madison County, it's very aria centric for me. And I really am so grateful for those opportunities, because otherwise in this day and age, I wouldn't really be having a career unless those things had happened.
Someone
I was astonished when I put these playlists together for today's broadcast between concerts and recordings and, of course, stage performances. You've performed practically every major role in the American theater golden age canon. You've done Eliza Doolittle, and you've done Babe in Pajama Game, and Fiona in Brigadoon. So is there any role out there that's, you know, that's climbing the next mountain that you, that we should hope and anticipate you'll take on?
Well, you know, I get to certain levels in my career and I think to myself, I don't want to do another, you know, I want to do something brand new that mm-hmm. someone writes for me. But then I'll have days where I hear something and I say, oh, I want to crack at that. You know, I want to point out, nobody ever knows that I did one time in an obscure theater in LA, I did Music Man, but my Miss Peru was Shirley Jones. Wow. I loved it. I love, especially the girl that, you know, watch movie musicals only practically, having, you know, Shirley Jones play with me when I did Marion was pretty extraordinary for me. I pinch myself about that. And so I've done that one too. I think as I get older though, and I pass up those particular types of roles, then we're looking at different things. And, you know, I've often said I could maybe take a crack at playing mother in The Light in the Piazza, as opposed to, because sure. that would mean I played all the female lead roles, because I started with Franca, moved to Clara, and then I would get myself to Margaret. But I don't know, if that never happens, it's okay. As far as the classic things go, I've sort of, you know, I think my preference would be, we need to start creating some new classics, you know, and sure. they are. And so what is it that you know, I've certainly welcome any Sondheim role at this point in my life, just because of the challenge of his beautiful compositions. I could revisit Follies again. I could,
sure.
I hope to surprise people and do Sweeney Todd at some point.
Great.
Because I yes. feel like I would surprise people if I did stuff like that. But
you could go from young Phyllis to actual Phyllis, right?
That's right. I could step in. You know, Laura Benanti and I joke that we're never even joke. I think it's a very serious thing that we would share and split the roles of Sally and Phyllis in a production of Follies and switch back
there.
And forth.
Yeah. I'll be there. I'll put my money down for that. Now, yeah. you sang a number. They don't let you in the opera on one of your albums, but they've let you in the opera, haven't they?
You know, that was written before they let me in the opera. And I have a lot of satisfaction to say, yeah, now that I'll be doing my third Metropolitan Opera this fall, I kind of laugh about that story.
Fantastic. And that's The Hours?
The Hours, yes. Yeah. Renee Fleming, Joyce DiDonato, a great opera by Kevin Putz and libretto by Greg Pierce. We'll be doing it November and December.
Well, if listeners can't wait that long, please come to West Hampton Beach Performing Arts Center on Sunday, July 17th at 8 p.m. to see Kelli O'Hara give us a spellbinding evening in the theater. She always, always does. Boy, you get your money's worth with Kelli O'Hara, in my opinion.
Osceola Station, where a truck will
I'd like to actually, if it's okay, play out with the song I found doing some digging, which I think is so pertinent to July, even though this will be broadcast July 10th, but to where we are. And that's Take Care of This House, which is a recording you did. And you haven't done that all that much Bernstein, have you?
No, I mean, I wouldn't do this now, but in high school, I got to play West Side Story, but I love Bernstein, and it was a joy to get to record and quite apropos to record Take Care of This House. And so I'm so glad. That's a nice one to choose. Thank you.
Yeah. What a beautiful way to go out, and what a beautiful performer in Kelli O'Hara. So don't miss her on July 17th. Thank you, Kelli, for joining us.
Thank you, Larry.
Take take care of this house, keep it from harm. If bandits break in, sound the alarm. Care for this house, shine it by hand, and keep it so clean the glow can be seen all over the land. Check all the doors. If someone makes off with a dream, the dream will be yours. Take care of this house. Be always on call, for this house is the hope of us all.
Well, where is the time all gone to? This is Larry Maslon here at Broadway to Main Street. Let's catch up next Sunday at 3.
There's so much more embracing still to be done, but time is racing. Oh, well, we'll catch up some other time.